We are starting this afternoon moving into the cyber world, and this is also not an invention of this century. It started long before in the 20th century, and a warm welcome from my side to Monika Fleischmann and Wolfgang Strauss, who will come on stage now. They have worked at Art and Com, which was an icon here in Germany. They will tell a bit about it. They were in Berlin here with Art and Com, and then they worked at Fraunhofer Institute and at other research institutions. And they promoted the connection between art and science, starting in the 80s already. And they belong to a small group of those pioneers who paved the way to the cyber world. With real-time interfaces, as well as virtual and mixed reality research. And I'm very proud that the two of them are joining now our stage. And I will put on the clock, as you already know, for your presentation. And I'm really looking forward to it. Thanks a lot.
I will not talk mainly about the start of Art plus Com, because this is a really long story. And it was the story also about, maybe many of you know about the Netflix film, A Billion Dollar Code. But when Wolfgang Strauss and I started working together as artists and architects, and I was just trained in computer graphics, we needed a space for interdisciplinary debate for our research. And we realized that when you want to work with computers, because we thought this is, our future, which will change our world, then we need to talk and to work as artists with scientists and with, at that time we called them nerds or computer scientists later. So we created in the 80s and 90s with Art plus Com, the Raum Labor at Art plus Com in Berlin and the Mars Media Arts Lab at Fraunhofer Research and eCulture Factory in Bremen. And we invented what we needed in these interdisciplinary teams, the software, the hardware, and also the objects, as Wolfgang is also a carpenter, not only an architect. So for us, generative art is about embracing the unexpected and appreciating the difference. Deconstruction, improvisation, and interpretation are important in our media art. We use the concept of thinking space to drive artistic research. We don't just interact with our audience, we engage with them. Initially, more by accident, we created generative objects between 0 and 1, by tweaking the numbers of geometric shapes, such as a cube. The resulting objects reveal infinite possibilities beyond our imagination. Deconstruction helps the artist and the viewer to create. The generative replaces the narrative. In this virtual reality experience, participants explore virtual buildings of thought inspired by Willem Flusser, Marvin Minsky, Paul Virilio and Josef Weizenbaum while wearing a data glove and a head-mounted display. These philosophers were the people we met at that time, and we found them most interesting and most important because of their opposing positions. And Minsky and Weizenbaum were opponents at the MIT Media Lab, and the experts then in artificial intelligence, and Virilio and Flusser were most important for us as philosophers, and all were talking about the digital future. As you move through the virtual environment, you will hear audio recordings of the philosophers' voices, making their opposing positions audible. They reflect the coming internet. Home of the Brain was one of the first artistic VR installations and a new public space in the global network of collective knowledge. Home of the Brain was for us the global computer brain.
Die Buben und Mädeln, die da vor den Terminalen sitzen und miteinander dank reversiblen Kabeln in Verbindung sind, die sind, die wenden der Politik den Rücken und einander, sie wenden sich einander zu. Und das ist eine neue Struktur, die nicht mehr Politik ist, sondern eine Vernetzungsstruktur.
Le nouvel espace est un espace vitesse. Ce n'est plus un espace temps, un espace où le temps est, je dirais, manipulé. Ce que nous manipulons, ce n'est plus le temps de l'homme, c'est le temps des appareils, c'est ce que j'appelle l'espace vitesse ou la droposphère.
In the meantime, the internet is evolving. With liquid views, we reveal how we see ourselves and how others see us. A video camera embedded in a touchscreen captures the visitor's image, then blends it with water simulation, just as if the image is reflected in real water. You look into a digital mirror and you see your reflection. Instinctively, you touch your image. A morphing algorithm transforms your reflection into digital waves. At first glance, Liquid Views recalls Caravaggio's Narcissus. Look closer and you will see an intimate act of self-reflection on a second, larger screen. What began as an inward gaze turns outward, engaging the audience and seeming to look back at them. Liquid Views anticipates the selfie culture. It allows us to see ourselves in others and others in us. In this reflection of reflections, the observer and the observed merge, creating a novel experience of a post-historical persona. We perceive ourselves while being seen by others, shaped by the gaze of those around us. In rigid waves, your reflection changes as you get closer. It is a mirror of dice time, where you see yourself even from behind. It makes you feel like you have a different body, as if you're dancing with your reflection. A hidden camera and a special algorithm change your appearance based on distance, revealing new aspects of yourself. So Wolfgang takes over now.
Part two, in the 90s, after these works, but also works from other artists, we recognized that immediately these works disappeared somehow. So we decided to build an archive for media art. Netzspannung.org means, the German term Netzspannung.org means spreading the net. In 2001, we launched Netzspannung.org, the first online platform for media arts community. It showcased works offered curated, open and curated channels and recorded lectures by renowned artists and scholars via the mobile unit. We hosted the Digital Sparks competition, mapping media arts education in the German-speaking world, and created a media arts learning series with 23 German university faculties. Today, the Netzspannung.org archive consists of several thousand documents and is hosted at the ZKM in Karlsruhe. It was funded for 5 years by the German Ministry of Research and Education and is now archived and under construction, actually. The problem with the archive is that it is just restricted, more or less restricted, to experts. So you have to see, you have to know what you're looking for. You have just this small little entrance where you type in your search. This is why we developed interfaces, alternative interfaces for the archive, like seen on the right side, the semantic map, the matrix, and the media flow. I must say that in the beginning of the Archive building, we had one sentence, one statement from Marvin Minsky in mind, which was, he said, imagine they had libraries where the books couldn't talk to each other. So this was the main approach for this archive, that it is not just a collection of single document by document, but that these documents could be related semantically together. So this is the semantic map. It uses neural network to analyze and presents the archive as a zoomable landscape. It uses, I said before, a neural network to identify relationships between documents. Based on self-organizing map, it groups related content into clusters. So each database, each data record, appears as a node in a network of artistic practice or scholarly topics. This is a difference in the method of retrieving, searching like just one certain document or object I'm looking for. The semantic map presents a series of related topics, as you can see in the small animation. And then the reader is encouraged to make distinctions and thus becomes a co-creator of meaning. This is a performative act of the semantic map. This is why we call these interfaces performative interfaces, because they foster to perform the interface. The semantic map helps us to understand how comparative reading makes us think. And this is also the example when I said, when I quoted Minsky, imagine libraries where the books couldn't talk to each other. The media flow and the matrix interface turn the digital archive into a database that can be experienced by museum visitors, as demonstrated at the ZKM in Karlsruhe. Left, the media flow stands for the flow of thoughts. The media flow left, it's floating image passed by your eyes, and via touchscreen you can select. Also, the data are semantically connected, so you get a bundle of data. The matrix interface is like a jukebox for video selection on the right side. It uses color code to differentiate the categories of art, design, and science. And you can select with our touchless point screen, which means just waving your hand, moving your hand, you can select on this touchless screen. All three interfaces, archive interfaces, let you view the structure of the archive at a glance. They support serendipitous discovery, letting visitors find and start exploring the archive. Energy Passages was a project which used all the findings with working with semantic text analysis, working with neural network. It was a site-specific installation displayed in the front of the House of Literature in Munich. Over the course of 4 weeks, the square came alive with words from the daily news. The newspaper was sorted by semantic data analysis and broken down into 500 most important keywords. It was a vibrant display of the power of words. Visitors were invited to choose the words they wanted to engage with. They could either speak or touch a pad to select them, creating a soundscape of reading and discussion. The words that people loved most were price, parents, sacrifice, love, food, girl. These words and interests stood out from the most common, more rational terms the newspaper often used, such as percent, years, millions, Germany. The result was a dynamic and inclusive public event where people could discuss and exchange ideas. Small example.
There came 4,000 people in the 4 weeks, yeah. And it was really, the people wanted to keep it there. So we feel that our deconstructivist data architecture empowers the audience to construct their own space of ideas, often in a collaborative way. This process is key to generating new insights by combining different perspectives. We refer to such situations as thinking space. Given the above, we reverse the conventional interface paradigm of what you see is what you get in favor of the more dynamic, performative interface of what you get is what you didn't see before. This is how you access the thinking space. This image of Birlinghofen Castle, where we had our Mars Lab at Fraunhofer AI, was transformed into a stunning generative series using the thinking machine's connection machine. Back in the 90s, the German art world showed little interest in this kind of work. We should love to exhibit our generative images. However, we have two upcoming projects, Liquid Views at the Tate Modern and the revival of Home of the Brain, where we are looking for the right production space because we want to develop a philosopher's language game where these four philosophers we invited,
philosophical language model,
because we want to show how they discuss against each other then in real time and supported by AI. We find that this is an interesting task. So thank you for your attention.